and play center field. Cecil Cooper, who had his 10-game hitting streak broken last night, is the DH. Coop batting third. Rob Deere in left field will hit fourth. Greg Brock at first base, batting fifth. Glenn Braggs in right field will hit sixth. B.J. Surhoff does the catching, and B.J. will bat seventh. The second baseman, Jim Gantner, will bat eighth. And Dale Swaim, the shortstop, hits ninth. It will be Len Barker against Walt Terrell tonight in game two of this three-game series. A little warmer here in Detroit tonight, a good night for baseball. The Tigers are just one half game behind the Brewers. Detroit with 29 and 25 as their record, the Brewers 29 and 24. Walt Terrell on the mound to take his warm-up tosses. And let's take a look at the Tigers' defense. Lineup a little different tonight with Darrell Evans at first base. Lou Whitaker, the second baseman. Alan Trammell at short. And Tom Brookins at third. In the outfield, there's Kirk Gibson, the left fielder. Chet Lemon in center field. And Pat Sheridan, the right fielder. Matt Noakes will do the catching as Sparky has his left-handers in there against Barker. And right-hander Walt Terrell on the mound. Terrell 4-6 with a 3.70 earned run average. He is making his 12th start of the year, his first start against the Brewers. Last time out, he was beaten by the Red Sox 9-5 at Fenway Park. But he has been a tough luck pitcher so far this year. In five of his losses, the Tigers scored two runs, three runs, four runs. The Tigers really were off to a slow start offensively. There you look at the Brewers' road record and the Tigers' home record. But as of May 6th, make that May 8th, the Tigers were hitting .239 as a team. Coming into tonight's ball game, Detroit is hitting .275 and leading the American League in hitting. So they have been red hot lately. And Terrell hoping to capitalize on some of that batting performance, the offensive performance. The Tigers scored eight runs last night for Jack Morris in winning game one. So we are about set to go. Jim Pechorek playing in his hometown steps in, and stepping in to bring you the play-by-play, here's Jim Paschke.
All right, Mike, another beautiful evening for baseball at Tiger Stadium. 5 weeks ago, the Brewers led Detroit by 11 games in the standings. Tonight, the Tigers, with a win, could move ahead of the Brewers into third place. Milwaukee trying to keep that from happening, of course, and the Brewers are looking for some offense. Jim Pechorek looks at the first pitch from Terrell. Pechorek hitting .297. He has five RBIs and a home run. His first major league leadoff appearance. The 0-2 pitch from Walt Terrell. Terrell is a 29-year-old Indiana native. Throws a fastball, a slider, a knuckle curve on occasion. And he'll throw a changeup.
Well, his best pitch still, I think, that fastball, especially when he sinks it. Dropped down on that pitch right there, but a couple. last year because he went away from the sinker.
Walked a lot of hitters too. The 2-2 pitch fouled straight back. Terrell had more walks than strikeouts last year. When he gets ahead in the count, he'll fool around with the knuckleball. Most often, Terrell will show you a first pitch fastball. Here's the 2-2 pitch. Again, foul back. Tom Trebelhorn and Andy Etchebarren. The Brewers have lost two games in a row, trying to turn that around here in game two with the Tigers. And Terrell gets off with a strikeout. Pachoric goes down swinging. Strikeout number one for Walt Terrell.
Looked like a slider. Let's take another look at the replay. That ball had a little dip to it, took something off, and you could see just had Jimmy Pachoric a bit out in front.
Detroit has won four straight games and 18 of the last 24, 10 of 12 here at Tiger Stadium. Walt Terrell's success at home. This is Robin Young. He looks at a ball.
Yeah, 4-1 here at Tiger Stadium, 0-5 on the road, and lifetime, well, at least since he's been in the American League and been a Tiger, he has loved to pitch at Tiger Stadium.
This time, Robin looks at a strike. 1-1 the count.
He is 23-7 at Tiger Stadium.
10-3 last season here. And Robin is behind in the count now. 1-2. Robin took the collar last night, 0-4, and had a three-game hitting streak snap. Thanks to Jack Morris. Morris winning his seventh straight game last night, 8-5, Detroit. Morris had some help from Mark Thurman in relief, but he pitched well. And there is strikeout number two. So Walt Terrell has something working tonight.
Well, he's made good pitches. That's what he has working. And in this one, again, right where they try to go after Robin, up and in, right on the hands. And he stayed inside on Robin that whole sequence. Terrell looks like he's still trying to get loose. If he's not loose the way he's throwing now, look out when he does get loose.
Well, if he's not loose, this man may be able to hurt him a little bit here. Cecil Cooper. Cecil had a 10-game hitting streak snap last night, but he has been very, very hot. He has hit in 13 of his last 15 games. In the last 11 games, 21 hits in 46 at-bats, and that works out to a .457 average. Cecil hitting .262 at the moment with four home runs. Terrell continues to work inside. 1-1. Two outs in the top of the first inning. Just underway at Tiger Stadium. Terrell has struck out Pachoric and Yount to open the ball game. Fouled out of play on the right side in the second deck. It is not quite as cool tonight at Tiger Stadium. A very pleasant evening. There is a seagull.
A little off course, isn't he?
trying to find his or her way out of Tiger Stadium and having some trouble down the right field line. Keeps flying toward the stands. Figures out that that's not the way to get out of here. A comebacker to Terrell on a 1-2 pitch, and Cecil Cooper is retired. So this game starts the way last night's did, with a 1-2-3 first inning. Nothing going for the Brewers in the first. The Tigers are coming up on the Brewer Television Network.
Padlock, the DH, bat second. Kirk Gibson hitting third. Alan Trammell, the shortstop, bats fourth. Matt Noakes, the catcher, hitting fifth. Pat Sheridan in right field, batting sixth. Darrell Evans, hit seventh. Chet Lemon, the center fielder, batting eighth, and Tom Brookins will bat ninth. Len Barker, 1-0 with a 5.40 earned run average, beat Kansas City his last time out after a no decision in his debut in Cleveland. Lou Whitaker, 2-for-5 last night with two runs. Hits the first pitch from Barker to Braggs over his head against the wall. Whitaker pulls up at second base with a leadoff double. Well, that didn't take long at all. One pitch and a runner at second base.
Well, the one thing that Barker did against Kansas City is that he got his breaking ball over this. It really didn't look like, in fact, I thought the way Whitaker swung at it, it was a breaking ball. Looks like if it was a fastball, he didn't have much on it. It was up and out over the plate. Braggs made a good attempt, but couldn't get back to the wall in time. But in Cleveland, Jim, when he got hit, he was working upstairs with the fastball a lot. A completely different pitcher his last time out against Kansas City, kept the ball down and got his breaking ball over.
In Cleveland, Barker threw the ball hard and high, and he was hit hard and high in that ball game. Bill Madlock, what a game he had last night in his Tiger Stadium debut. 4-for-5 with two runs, and Madlock drove in two of Detroit's eight runs last night. This is Madlock's second stint in the American League. He broke into the majors with Texas in 73 and played 21 games with the Rangers. Fouled at the plate, 0-2 the count.
Well, he's a good number two hitter. He can put the bat on the ball. He doesn't strike out very much. And he can take the ball the other way to the opposite field.
Madlock uses that short bat, and he has a short stroke.
He's got it choked up, too.
The infield at normal depth, the 0-2 pitch, runner at second base. The ball is outside, so it's one ball and two strikes. The top third of the Tiger order last night, very productive. 9-for-15 with five runs and four RBI for Sparky Anderson. The rest of the lineup did a fair job as well. Barker coming in 1-2. On the ground, foul of third. Pachoric makes the play. Paul Molitor still bothered with a sprained right ankle after the collision at third base with Bobby Meacham on Saturday night. Molitor missed Sunday's game and did not play last night. He took infield and batting practice. The ankle is still tender. The 1-2 pitch. Again, fouled back to the screen.
Sign of a good hitter right there. Madlock able to get a piece of a couple of pitches that were really the pitcher's pitch. Went with a breaking ball away, and he tapped it foul and then fought off that fastball, trying to put the ball in play.
Madlock puts the ball in the air. Yount coming on hard, and he cannot make the catch. Braggs is there, the throw to third, not in time. Madlock stays at first base. Whitaker moves over on the base hit by Madlock. And again, just as happened last night, the first two hitters in the Tiger lineup have base hits. Last night, the first three hitters hit safely.
Well, that was kind of a strange looking play. I think that Braggs had a shot at that ball, Jim. A long run for Robin. He can't get to it. This is a very, very tough center field to play. There's Whitaker, who had to hold up because he thought Robin was going to make the catch.
And now Kirk Gibson steps in off speed from Barker, misses for a ball. Gibson 3-for-5 in last night's ball game, and he drove in two runs.
Well, you really have to learn how to play this outfield.
Runners at the corners, no outs. Two balls, no strike.
Excuse me, Jim. We talked about it last night. 440 feet to center field. A lot of room out there. And, well, I know as an outfielder, you look back and you see how far you are from the wall. You think you're playing too shallow.
Two and one the count now to Kirk Gibson. I think a few people are wondering why the press box is moving. Did you notice that?
Well, I did. I didn't want to say anything. I thought it was me.
I wondered about myself. Everybody is looking at each other up here.
Okay.
As if it had never happened before. There's a ball hit hard center field. Yount moving to his right. He can't make the play. It'll score a run. Whitaker comes in to make it 1-0. Manlock behind him. Gibson will be held at third. And that is a rarity in baseball, a stand-up triple. Perhaps not in this ballpark. 400 to the wall where that ball ended up. 440 to deep center field. Gibson with a triple. Two runs are in.
Well, I'm going to tell you something. I think if that ball hadn't been recovered, if Gibson would have kept going, he might have passed Madlock. Boy, he was flying. There you see Deer retrieve the ball, and Gibson was into third base before Madlock crossed home plate. Boy, he's got some speed. And they are hitting Barker fairly hard here in the first.
Two runs are in. A runner at third, no outs. And we are looking at the American League's hottest hitter, Alan Trammell, 357. He leads the American League. Barker missed with the first pitch. Gibson has a set of wheels. He has always been gifted with speed. This will drive in another one. It's 3-0. Four consecutive hits to open this ball game tonight. A double by Whitaker, a single by Madlock, a two-run triple by Gibson, and now an RBI single to left for Alan Trammell.
Alan was able to get up on top of that fastball, and I tell you, Jim, that's one reason it doesn't look to me like Barker has really got his good stuff. Aren't too many times if Barker's thrown up there 90 miles an hour that you're going to get on top and turn his fastball to left field.
The top four hitters in the Detroit lineup in this series are now 15 for 24. With 8 runs and 7 RBI. John Henry Johnson up in the Brewer bullpen. And all you have to do now is face Matt Noakes. A ball got away from the bullpen area. Braggs is retrieving it in right field, so as soon as he gets back into position, Matt Noakes will face Len Barker. Noakes hitting 323 with 11 home runs.
Now, there's not much question about his offensive abilities. The question with Noakes is how he's going to be able to handle himself behind the plate.
Platooning with Heath. I guess so. Hits are us. You know what that movement was in the press box? We are told, and you're not going to like this, Detroit just had a minor earthquake.
Ooh.
Now, I've been in the stadium at Camp Randall in Madison, and that press box moves, but this was a very subtle kind of a movement. Your first thought was, my stomach is upset. We just had an earthquake at Tiger Stadium.
Just a bit of an undulation.
Why not? Everything else has happened. It might be the bats. It might be repercussions from these Detroit hitters. Here's the 1-2 pitch to Noakes. the fifth consecutive base hit. Trammell moves to third. Runners at the corners, still no outs.
Now, Barker, again, I tell you, Jim, he's working under the baseball. You can really see it, and leaving everything up in the strike zone. He doesn't have good down action on his breaking ball, and his fastball is up and fairly straight. And that's going to be all for Lenny Barker. John Henry Johnson will come on. We've got a pitching change, and we'll be back to tell you about John Henry after these messages on the Brewer Television Network.
Up the middle. Here's the 1-2 pitch. Through the hole between third and short. Another run is in. Trammell gives Detroit a 4-0 lead. Noakes moves over to third, and Evans has the sixth base hit in the inning.
Well, you know, it. Here's a look right here. Look at this pitch. Slow breaking ball away. They're playing him to pull up the middle and throw him slow stuff away. It just opens that big hole in the defense, and Evans found it.
RBI number 28 for Darrell Evans. Chet Lemon steps up. He went 1-for-4 last night with a run driven in. One more hitter, and we will have seen the entire Detroit lineup here in the first. This is fouled out of play. Up on the roof. A James Taylor foul ball up on the roof. There you see Lemon's numbers, 6 home runs. One ball and one strike. There's our friend still trying to find its way out of Tiger Stadium.
Got some company now, though.
It has a partner, doesn't it? Well, actually, there are a few more seagulls in the ballpark. 2 balls and 1 strike to Chet Lemon. Detroit has 4 runs on 6 hits, and there is just 1 out in the first inning. Lemon turns on the inside pitch and drives it into the dugout. San Francisco beat Cincinnati this afternoon. That's a final in the National League, 9-4. The Giants over the Reds. Atlanta leads Los Angeles 7-1 in the seventh. We'll keep you apprised of the scores tonight. And Lemon is down on strikes. Out number 2, the first strikeout in the game for Brewer pitching. They have already made a change. John Henry Johnson on in relief of Len Barker.
Another look at that last pitch from John Henry to Lemon, right in on the hands of Chet Lemon.
So the Tigers have batted around here in the first. Number 9 hitter Tom Brookins hitting .268. 1 ball and no strikes. Brookins 1-for-3 in the game last night. Popped up. It should be playable. Gantner is back. And he makes the catch. The Brewers get out of the inning. But damage has been done. The Tigers score 4 in the first and lead 4-0 after 1 at Tiger Stadium on the Brewer Television Network. Stadium tonight. The 0-2 pitch. Back to the screen.
Well, I think that was that knuckle curveball that got away from him.
We were watching Terrell warm up tonight, and that knuckler dances when it is on. It is obviously difficult to put over the plate.
Yeah, that was it. That one danced right off the floor.
So the count is 1 ball and 2 strikes to Rob Deere. leading off the second inning for Milwaukee. And he's gone. A called third. Strikeout number three for Terrell. John Schulock rings up Rob Deere.
Set up right on the outside corner, and that ball came back right down the middle. I don't know what Robbie was looking for, but there it was, right down the middle of the plate. He has been in a bit of a slump lately, has Deere. His average has dropped considerably, and talking to Tony Muser about it, he feels that Rob has gone away from the philosophy that he had in spring training and early in the year.
This is Greg Brock. It's the second pitch from Terrell on the ground. Whitaker at second. And there are two down here in the second inning. Terrell has retired the first five Brewer batters tonight. Deere is what, Mike? Starting to lift the ball again?
Looks like he's trying to lift everything out of the ballpark. That's the type of hitter he is, but I feel he can help himself more by using more of the field. I believe Tony Muser feels that way, too.
Glenn Braggs went 0-for-3 last night. He had a seven-game hitting streak going, a career-high hitting streak, and that has been snapped. And he can start another one with his 100th career hit. His next hit will be number 100. Detroit leads 4-0. We're in the second inning. Nobody on, two outs. That may be it. No, not this time. Pat Sheridan goes a long way to get it. 1-2-3 again for the Brewers in the second. After 1.5 at Tiger Stadium, it's Detroit 4, Milwaukee nothing on the Brewer Television Network. This copyrighted program is authorized under television rights granted by the Milwaukee Brewers Baseball Club solely for the entertainment of our audience. Any publication, reproduction, retransmission, or other use of the pictures, descriptions, or accounts of this game without the express written consent of the Milwaukee Brewers Baseball Club and WVTV is prohibited.
Well, nice play by Pat Sheridan in right field. He made it look easy, didn't he? Got a good jump on that ball and ran it down in the right field corner.
That prevented a hit by Glenn Braggs. The Brewers have been retired 1-2-3 in the first two innings. This is Lou Whitaker. He led off the game with a double and scored. Driven in by Kirk Gibson. Gibson had a stand-up triple. Schulock calls a second strike. 0-2 the count to Whitaker. The umpires tonight, Schulock at home. Ken Kaiser at third base. Jim McKean at second. And Larry Young at first. No balls and two strikes for leadoff hitter Lou Whitaker. One and two the count. Whitaker has been such a fixture at second base. Whitaker and Trammell have never played another position for the Tigers. Whitaker at second, Trammell at shortstop.
Well, they have come through the minor league system together. They've been here in the big leagues for, this is their 10th year, I believe, in the big leagues together.
John Henry Johnson with the 1-2 outside, two balls and two strikes.
And their career statistics, Jim, if you look at them, are so close.
The count is full now. Well, they're both outstanding fielders, as everyone knows. Alan Trammell, Golden Gloves in four of the last 5 years. Whitaker lost his Golden Glove last year to Frank White of Kansas City. Fouled back, and that catches the mask of John Schulock. The count remains full at three balls and two strikes. The Tigers made a roster move today. They placed first baseman Dave Bergman on the disabled list as you look at the foul ball off the mask. That stings, doesn't it? He may need a new mask.
He might need another mask, is right.
You saw Shulock pull the mask off. Anytime an umpire gets hit, he will take that mask off and check the wires to make sure that nothing is bent or out of place. And apparently that is the case. Shulock with new iron. Bergman goes on the disabled list, 15 days, effective back to June 7th. He has a pulled hamstring muscle. And Morris Madden, the left-handed pitcher, has been recalled from Toledo. If the situation dictates, I wouldn't be surprised if we would see Madden, because Sparky Anderson likes to use people when he calls them up. The 3-2 pitch. Hit in the air, and Deer makes a fine play in foul territory, retiring Whitaker. One down in the Tigers' second inning for Bill Madlock. Madlock is 5-for-6 in this series. He has scored 3 runs and has done just about everything you can ask at the plate. The Tigers have won 4 of 5 games since acquiring Madlock. He was released by the Dodgers last week and then picked up by Detroit. Sparky Anderson had the Yogi Berra quote of the day today regarding Madlock. 2 balls and no strikes. Sparky said he knows how to play the game, and knowing how to play doesn't mean you can do something.
I beg your pardon?
I had to read that.
Run that by me one more time, will you?
He knows how to play the game.
Mm-hmm.
And knowing how to play doesn't mean you can do something. This time he flies out to Robin Yount, 2 down in the second. I had to read that at least 4 times before I figured out I couldn't figure it out.
Was there an explanation?
I think it means he's a decent player and he can do more than hit. Some people question Madlock's defense, but right now nobody is thinking about it because he is tearing up the league offensively in his first 6 games. All right, Kirk Gibson tripled in 2 runs in the first inning. Inside to the left-handed batter. That triple, the second of the season for Gibson. 1 ball and 1 strike. Mike mentioned how the Tigers have raised their team batting average from 239 to 275 since May 8th. They have gone 19-8 in that span, and over those 27 games, the Tigers have averaged 7.3 runs.
Sounds like the Brewers during that streak early in the year.
Very similar. Gibson swings and misses. It's a 1-2-3 inning on the second strikeout for John Henry Johnson. We have completed 2 at Tiger Stadium. Detroit leads 4-0 on the Brewer Television Network.
The count remains 2 balls and 2 strikes on B.J. Sirhoff. His average now up to 277. It's a little looping fly ball, foul territory, easy play for Evans, and there's 1 out. It's time to announce tonight's contestant for the Miller Lite Rally Inning Contest. Jeanette Acker of Sturtevant, Wisconsin, wins a Brewer warm-up jacket just for sending in a postcard, and now has a chance to win the VIP treatment package at County Stadium if the Brewers score during the 7th inning. So we'll give you more information as that comes up. And good luck to Janet Acker of Sturtevant, Wisconsin, tonight in the 7th inning. Here's an Eden, Wisconsin native, Jim Gandner. And Gumby hitting at 281. A couple of base hits last night and a run batted in. There's a strike. 1 ball, 1 strike, and 1 out. If you're just joining us, the Tigers got to Len Barker for 4 runs in the first. Barker failed to get anybody out in that inning. He was relieved by John Henry Johnson. There's a line drive base hit. So the first base hit for the Brewers tonight. Gantner aboard with one out.
Fastball, outside part of the plate. Gantner had a couple of hits last night, and he is the first Brewer to reach base in game two here against the Tigers.
Dale Swaim steps to the plate for the first time. Swaim 0 for 4 last night and looks at a ball outside. Terrell was 1-1 against the Brewers last year, 3-1 lifetime versus Milwaukee. Strike called. Four runs on six base hits for Detroit. And Swaim fouls this back, a ball and two strikes. Mark Handless is here tonight. Mark from Brookfield over here on business and enjoying the ball game. Also, Harold Hart from Marshall, Wisconsin.
And Cindy Van Meter, an assistant sports information director at Michigan State, is here, and she is a Wisconsin native. Her grandparents watch every game, she tells us. Earl and Hazel Whitford in Mineral Point, Wisconsin, and Cindy Van Meter wanted to say hello.
Looked like that foul tip caught Noakes on the throwing hand. It was a changeup. You can see Swaim is way out in front here and just does get a piece. And Noakes, like it caught him on the hand. High ball two. Two balls and two strikes on the switch hitting Dale Swaim, batting from the left side against Terrell. The runner was going, but the pitch fouled back. And Gantner will go back to first. Now we get a report from Jim Holmes through our TV 18 studios in Milwaukee that a few buildings shook back in the Milwaukee area. 2-2 pitch. There goes Gantner again and again. Swaim fouls it back out of play. So Gantner getting a workout. Swaim batting 239 overall. 234 from the left side and 246 as a right-handed hitter. Three home runs from each side of the plate. Gantner will stay this time, and Swaim looks at a fastball down low. So the count is full, 3-2. And Gantner, who had been on the run the two previous pitches, let's see if he goes this time with the count full. There's the pitch, there he goes. Ball hit in the air, left field. Gibson is there, and there are two out.
This is the 54th game of the season, Mike, which makes the season one-third old, and I was just thinking back on all of the things we have seen and now felt in 54 games. It's been incredible. 13-game winning streaks, 12-game losing streaks, a no-hitter, an earthquake.
A little bit of everything, and we probably haven't seen everything yet. There'll be more.
The Easter parade, the two home runs on Easter Sunday.
Pachurik up there for the second time tonight and hits the tremble at short. He'll go to Whitaker for the force out. And in the third here for the Brewers, no runs, a hit, one man left. We go to the bottom of the third. The score, Detroit 4, Milwaukee nothing on the Brewer Television Network. bottom of the third at Tiger Stadium, Detroit leading 4-0. And it will be 4, 5, and 6 for Sparky Anderson, Trammell, Noakes, and Sheridan against John Henry Johnson. Trammell has now hit in 15 straight. A base hit off Barker in the first, a single to left to drive home a run. The 1-0 pitch inside, two balls and no strikes. So Trammell, who came in leading the American League at 357, his average has risen another 3 points. He is at 360 right now with 6 home runs and 28 runs batted in. 2-0 pitch, line, nice play by Pachorek. Ball hit hard off the bat of Trammell, but right at Jim Pachorek.
Fastball up, and Pachorek puts an end, at least momentarily, to the American League's number one hitter, Alan Trammell. Trammell 1-4-2 in the ball game, a hit, a run scored with an RBI.
A hard end. That was a hard out. You see those good hitters like Trammell and Matlock, Mattingly, Boggs. When they make outs, they make hard outs. That ball was hit so hard, Pachorek started to jump for it and then caught it about chest high. Noakes singled his first time up. Ball get away from Johnson. And it's two balls and no strikes. Talk about Matt Noakes. He's had some good minor league numbers, and he's already put some good major league numbers up here in his first 2 months in Detroit. 11 home runs and 36 runs batted in. They say he may eventually wind up as a first baseman. A little erratic in both his throwing and receiving of the baseball behind the plate. Of course, he could obviously improve in those departments. He walked him on 4 straight pitches. First walk given up by John Henry. He has struck out 2 and given up a base hit. Since coming on for Barker with nobody out in the first inning. Sheridan was released by Kansas City. That was a bit of a shock, I think, when that happened, Jim. Sheridan had a good year for Kansas City. He's got some pretty good ability. He can run, throw. You saw him go after that ball off the bat of Braggs. He made a fine running catch. But I think the one thing, and that Sheridan has tried to work on, he's going to have to get a new bat. But I think he was trying to go long ball a little too much. His batting average suffered. He struck out. He is not a home run hitter, but he got into that home run syndrome, and as a result was striking out a lot, trying to pull everything. And he came to spring training this year with the idea that he was going to try to use the whole ball field, and so far he's been successful, hitting around 300.
Sheridan has worked with Harry Walker on that very thing, learning how to be a contact hitter. You know, I remember hearing or reading somewhere that one of the reasons he was released at Kansas City was because he was too laid back. Now, that I hadn't heard before.
Nope.
But maybe not intense enough. He's gone on strikes this time.
Third strikeout for Johnson. Good slider and a good spot. And Sheridan is 0 for 1. He sacrificed his first time up. Evans singled off John Henry and drove in a run back in the first. Johnson got a breaking ball up and away, and Evans poked it to left field. Brewer defense has Swain playing almost behind second base. The outfield shifted way around toward right for Evans, who was a dead pull hitter. Good power. Led the American League in home runs a couple of years ago. And just misses this one. High in the air to right field. Braggs will put it away, and the Tigers down here in the third inning. They leave one, and after three from Tiger Stadium, the score, Detroit 4, Milwaukee nothing, on the Brewer Television Network. Walt Terrell has shut the Brewers down on just one base hit through the first three. It will be out Cooper and Deer here in the fourth, and Robin takes a fastball high and inside. Welcome along our network tonight to WMSN TV 47 in Madison, WLAX TV 25 in La Crosse, WGBA TV 26 in Green Bay, and WFGX TV 35 in Fort Walton Beach, Florida. Of course, our flagship station, WVTV Super 18 in Milwaukee. It's called Shaky 18 in Milwaukee tonight. That earthquake. Super shaky, I guess, huh? Outside, two balls and one strike. We felt a brief tremor over here at Tiger Stadium. You don't stop to think about it with the age of this ballpark. I wonder what the underpinnings are like here.
I thought about it.
You did, huh? Robin is 0 for 1, a strikeout victim back in the first inning. Terrell has struck out three, not walked a batter. The only base hit, a one-out single by Jim Gantner in the second. High ball three. The Brewers and Tigers will wind up this series tomorrow afternoon. Robinson will go for Detroit, Wegman for Milwaukee, then it's on to New York for the weekend. A leadoff walk to Yount. The first base on balls issued by Terrell. And the Brewers had the lead runner aboard here in the fourth. Terrell has thrown 50 pitches, 33 strikes. Pretty good ratio right there. It's about a 66% ratio taken out to 100, isn't it? That's not too bad. Check swing. Cooper got a piece of it, taps it foul. We have the pitching matchups for New York. On Friday, it will be Rasmussen against Krim. On Saturday, Roden and Nieves, and then Sunday, Guidry and Higuera, as the Brewers travel to Yankee Stadium. Coop fouls back. He's in the hole. No balls and two strikes.
So Juan Nieves will have missed one start after being struck on the knee in the New York series at home last week.
We will have all three of those games for you right here on Super 18. Hit in the air, center field. Lemon going back, and makes the catch at the warning track about 430 feet away. Boy, oh boy. Cooper hit it a ton. But Lemon, with the good jump and good speed, here's another look.
Cooper really gives it a ride anywhere else in the ballpark, and it might have had a chance. 440 to straightaway center field, and that ball was right on line with the 440 sign.
One out, and Rob Deere, the hitter. couldn't hold up on a breaking ball, and Terrell out in front, 0-1. After that Yankees series, it will be back to Milwaukee for a brief homestand. The Twins are in the 15th, 16th, and 17th of June.
That's a laundry homestand.
Because I don't know if I can get it that quick. You are right about that. Monday night, Tuesday night, and a Wednesday afternoon game.
That's a high goodbye deal. Right back out to Toronto and Boston.
During that Twins homestand, one of the more popular promotions at County Stadium. Swing and a miss, and Deer is gone for the second time tonight. Strikeout number four for Terrell.
The first time Deer was called out on strikes. This time he swings at a breaker. Another good pitch. Both third strikes to Deer have been outstanding pitches. This time he misses.
So they're two out, and Greg Brock is the hitter, and he looks at a fastball on the outside corner. On June 16th, which is Tuesday night, it will be Fuji Sundance photo camera night at County Stadium. Fans with cameras are out on the field at 6:30 to take pictures of their favorite players, and that is always a popular night. So that is Tuesday night, June 16th, against the Twins.
I wonder if the blimp will be there.
That's right, it was in Cleveland, wasn't it? Fouled into the upper deck. A ball and two strikes on Greg Brock after a leadoff walk to Yount. Cooper retired on a fine running catch by Lemon in center field, and then Terrell struck out Deer. He's ahead of Brock, 1-2. Fouled back. One ball, two strikes, two outs. The Brewers trailing the Tigers and Walt Terrell 4-0 here in the fourth inning.
Greg Brock was working with Tony Muser before the game, Mike, on the hands. The hands are back. He had a tendency to have the hands in close and then in his starting motion bring them back and threw the ball. Muser said, if you're going to bring them back, start them back. Watch the hands of Brock.
Try to shorten that stroke a little bit. They've been trying to work on that since spring training. Easy play for Whitaker, and Terrell and the Tigers out of it here in the fourth as Brock goes out 4-3 for the second time tonight. No runs, no hits. A man left after 3.5 from Tiger Stadium. It's Detroit 4, Milwaukee nothing on the Brewer Television Network. This is Watch an Unusual Special, where prison convicts try to help juvenile delinquents and scared straight 10 years later. Host Whoopi Goldberg Monday at 8 on Super 18. Some young baseball fans here tonight. They look about camp age, don't they, Jim?
You run camps over here, too?
No, not over here, no. We got a couple of seconds here. Just thought we might update you on the Grand Slam summer camps coming up, starting next week, as a matter of fact. June 15th to 19th at Zablocki Park on the south side of Milwaukee. Then the 22nd to the 26th will be up in at Concordia College in the Mequon area. In Waukesha, June 29th to July 3rd. Down at Salem Central High School from the 6th to the 10th, and up in West Bend for the first time on July 13th to 17th, and we still have openings in all of those camps as Chet Lemon leads it off. So if you want any information, give a call over to Grand Slam at 781-7526. Got some Brewer players coming out to make appearances. There's Juan Nieves getting some throwing for his start. Hit in the air, short center field. Could be a bit tough to see. Swaim going back, and Swaim makes the catch.
Those are day camps, right?
Yep. About the, this is the fifth year that we have done it. Started about 5 years ago with Kenny Sanders. Had some fun with it. And the kids have a good time. Third baseman Tom Brookins for the second time. He drives one deep, but Robin now drifting back. I think Robin had him played a little bit deeper than normal. Robin got burned twice tonight. Once on a ball hit by Madlock to shallow center field in the first inning, and then Gibson followed with a ball over his head and into the gap in left center field. A lot of room in center field in Tiger Stadium. Two outs, and Lou Whitaker up for the third time. He is one for two and looks at a strike. Count even, one ball and one strike. He led off the Tiger first with a double off Barker and eventually scored. Well, I'll tell you, I remember back to the first inning, Jim, when he hit that first pitch. The way he hit it, I thought he went after a breaking ball. I believe it was his fastball, but that was just an omen of things to come because Lenny Barker just did not have it tonight. Popped up behind third base, foul territory. And an easy 1-2-3 inning for John Henry and the Brewers here in the fourth. The Tigers go down in order after four from Tiger Stadium. The score remains Detroit 4, Milwaukee nothing on the Brewer Television Network. And it will be Bragg, Surhoff, and Gantner against Terrell. And stepping back to bring you the play-by-play, here's Jim Paschke.
All right, thank you, Mike. 4-0 as we move into the fifth inning. All four runs scored in the first by the Tigers. Four runs on six hits. Lenny Barker was chased out of this game before we had a chance to talk about his perfect game back in 1981 against Toronto while he was with Cleveland. This was the first appearance on the Brewer Network by Lenny Barker, and he did not stick around very long. Here's the 0-1 pitch to Braggs, inside from Terrell. Be sure and stay with us tonight for the end of our game. We will have the Miller Lite Super 18 Mac Fund winner, our player of the game. One ball and one strike to Glenn Braggs. Terrell misses away, 2-1.
Well, I think the one thing that, the one area of concern, Jim, and with Barker was how he would come back, how he would respond.
A ball hit deep to right, and that is gone. A home run for Glenn Braggs into the upper deck. And that is career hit number 100 for Braggs. And that's not a bad way to do it, Mike, with your seventh home run of the season.
Well, it tells you about that short porch in right field, too, doesn't it? Boy, you don't have to pull the ball here. Just hit it where it's pitched. That ball was away. Braggs hit it well. High fastball. And BJ lays down a bunt.
He's at it again, and he beats it out. That is the third time in recent memory that Surhoff has bunted for a base hit. He did it in Cleveland. He beat the Yankees with a two-out, bases-loaded bunt for a hit on Saturday night. And he comes up with another surprise here, so the Brewers have a runner on first. One run is in, no outs in the fifth. It's a 4-1 ball game. Jimmy Gantner is at the plate. He came up with the first hit in the ballgame for Milwaukee, a single. In the third, he was cut down 6-4 on a ground ball hit by Pachurik.
Pretty soon, it's not going to be a surprise anymore, Jim. There are, oh.
All hands are safe. The ball off the glove of Terrell. Whitaker fielded the ball. Surhoff did a stutter step on the base path and worked around him. That is an error on Whitaker.
Well, Terrell got a piece. This ball hit extremely hard back through the middle. I think that ball had a little English on it. And when it came up, here's another look. That ball bounced back. BJ stopped. He was going to make Whitaker tag him, but then goes on to second base. So runners at first and second. And nobody out. Let's see what Trev might have Swaim doing here.
He squares to bunt and pushes it foul. Let's pause 5 seconds for station identification. You're on the Milwaukee Brewer Television Network.
You're watching the Brewers tackle the Tigers on Super 18 WVTV Milwaukee.
Jim Paschke and Mike Hegan with you from Tiger Stadium. Game two between the Brewers and the Tigers in this three-game series. They'll wrap it up tomorrow afternoon. Again, Swaim squares to bunt. This is a good one. Terrell throws him out. The runners move over. Surhoff to third. Gantner to second on the sacrifice. 1-3 on the putout. Dale Swaim. And now we go back to the top of the order. And Jim Pechorek.
Well, see if Jimmy can do his job here. As the Tiger infield is playing back, they'll give the Brewers a run. So basically, not the only spot Pechorek doesn't want to hit the ball is at third base, hard at third base. And he did, but they're still going to score him.
Brookins with a fine defensive play. He knocked the ball down and threw out Pechorek, but the run scores. It's now 4-2. Surhoff comes in with the second run of the inning for Milwaukee.
Well, Pechorek hit it hard, but he hit it to Brookins right. There you see right there. A good jump by Surhoff on contact, so Brookins really didn't have a play at the plate. Had he hit the ball hard right at him, there you see he had to dive at that ball going to his left. So that allowed BJ to score, and Pechorek gets the job done.
A contact play, we've talked about that from time to time. The runner at third moving on any contact at the plate. Yount pops up the first pitch foul. And Evans can't get there. He ran out from under his cap and just missed the put out in foul territory.
Take that one step further, Jim. It's any ground ball contact. You have to look at that ball off the bat. If it's hit on the line or in the air, you don't break with one out. You go back to the bag. So any ball that is hit on the ground is the one that you make the break to the plate.
It wouldn't work on a line drive, would it?
Double play.
No balls and a strike to Young. Again to Brookins, and again a fine defensive play, a long throw. And Yount is retired. Brookins has a busy inning at third base. The Brewers come up with two runs on two hits after four and a half. It's 4-2 Detroit on the Brewer Television Network. A 4-2 lead into the bottom of the fifth inning. Madlock, Gibson, and Trammell set to face John Henry Johnson. It's time to suit up with Cons, and here's our winner tonight, George Rogers. From Milwaukee, Wisconsin, wins a $100 gift certificate and four Brewer tickets. Stop in at any Con store and you could be the next to suit up with Con. George Rogers of Milwaukee, our suit up with Con's contest winner. Bill Madlock hitting .520 in this his sixth game with the Detroit Tigers. A pitch away from John Henry Johnson. Madlock singled and scored in the first and flied out to Robin Yount in center field in the second inning. The 1-0 pitch inside, two balls and no strikes. In five games with Detroit, and this holds for tonight's sixth game for Madlock, he has more runs, more hits, and more doubles than he did in 21 games with the Los Angeles Dodgers. In 21 games, Madlock had scored five runs. He has eight runs scored for the Tigers. He had 11 hits in 21 games with the Dodgers, 13 hits now in six games with Detroit, and he has a couple of doubles. He doubled once for Los Angeles. Sirhoff runs out of room by about 3 feet. Two balls and two strikes to Madlock.
Afternoon game in Cincinnati, Jim, the Giants beat the Reds for the second time. Final score 9-4, and San Francisco now just a game behind Cincinnati in the West. The Mets and Dwight Gooden over the Cubs 13-2.
The 2-2 pitch. The count is full now to Bill Madlock. A couple of American League pitchers are going for their eighth victories tonight. Jimmy Key for Toronto facing Tommy John. Key is 7-3. And Charlie Liebrandt takes a 7-4 record against Bert Blylevin in Minnesota. How are they doing? Toronto leads New York 3-0 in the third inning. And Kansas City scored a run in the first to lead Minnesota 1-0, and they are just moving into the third. Three balls, two strikes to Bill Madlock, the leadoff hitter for the Tigers here in the fifth inning. A smash, just foul.
You talk about short and quick. He is so short and quick with those hands. Get the head of the bat out. That was a fastball inside, but he just got it out and hooked it.
The 3-2. And Madlock is alive. It was tipped. A foul ball at the plate. This guy uses most of the field. He's a good spray hitter between the gaps. Foul by inches this time. Well, he can use the entire field on occasion, too, can't he? We mentioned that Madlock began his major league career in Texas, playing in 21 games back in 1973. Now, as he approaches the end of his career at 36 years old, and we're not rushing it, but he is getting near the end.
Well, the thing that he does so well, he's going to think about it a little bit. Let's see. They've been trying to jam him inside. Let's see if they go off speed away here. And Madlock will take you to the opposite field. That was inside.
And Pachoric misplays the ball at third base. Madlock is in at second.
I'll tell you, BJ wanted that pitch away, but they're going to go talk about it now. See where Sirhoff was set up, away. I think Pachoric thought that ball was going to get a piece of the bag. It stayed down under his glove. And Madlock winds up at second base.
To continue the point on Madlock at 36, the role of designated hitter and a grass field won't hurt him at all.
Nor will the dimensions of this ballpark.
That's a fact. This is Kirk Gibson. A stand-up triple in the first inning to drive in two runs. He struck out in the second. Gibson is 4-for-6 in the series. Two balls and no strikes.
An error charge to Pachoric. So both clubs now with an error.
Mike, Juan Nieves is warming up, and I just had the thought, we may see him out of the bullpen. Well, he is scheduled to start this weekend, but he might get a little work in here. I know Tom Treblehorn had been thinking about bringing him in out of the pen in between starts. We mentioned that Nieves, of course, missed the start because of being hit on the knee, the right knee, on a shot by Ron Kittle of New York. So we could see Nieves. He may be warming up in earnest.
Well, this is would be his day to throw between starts.
Two balls and two strikes to Kirk Gibson. Gibson with home run power, of course, to all fields. He has five home runs so far this year. He has a tendency to open up that lead shoulder and get a little wild at the plate sometimes, doesn't he?
Free swinger.
Let's see what he does with a full count and a runner at second base. Ball hit to Swaim at short. He makes the play. Madlock moves over to third. Gibson retired on a ground ball, the first out in the Tiger fifth inning.
Well, he did it right there, what you were talking about, Jim. He really opened up that front shoulder on a breaking ball away, but he kept his hands back. He still got a piece of the ball and was able to advance the runner. Gibson is so strong. He's not what you would call a finesse player in any area, whether it be in the field or at the plate. He just muscles everything and powers everything.
Alan Trammell hitting 360. He has increased his average 3 points tonight with an RBI single and a run scored in the first. Trammell lined out on a hard smash to Pachoric at third base. Two balls and no strikes to the 1984 World Series MVP. Trammell has a 15-game hitting streak going with that single in the first, and he has hit safely in 26 of 27 ball games.
Well, they're not going to give him much to hit at in this situation. 2-0 fork ball there by John Henry. You've got the runner at third base, and you've got two left-handers coming up behind Trammell, so I would think that they're just going to try to pitch around him here, or at least make him hit their pitch.
Matt Noakes and Pat Sheridan are the left-handers. One out. Madlock is on third. The infield is drawn up to the edge of the grass.
Well, you don't want to give in to Trammell right here. Still got to make him hit the pitch that you want him to hit.
Three balls and a strike.
It was a breaking ball, but it was right in the middle of the plate. Got away with a mistake.
The count is full. Runners at the corners with one out. The second walk given up by John Henry Johnson. And now he will face the left-hander, Matt Noakes. Noakes has singled and walked tonight. And Tom Treblehorn is out of the Brewer dugout. He will meet on the mound with B.J. Surhoff and John Henry Johnson. Matt Noakes has not left the batter's box. He's taking his practice swings, getting ready to go. Nieves still throwing and getting ready in the Brewer bullpen.
Well, I think what they're doing, of course, this is the first time that they have seen Noakes. And they're going to make sure that they know how they're going to pitch him. This is a very key situation in the ball game here, Jim. The Brewers have just scored two runs to get back into it. An error to lead off the fifth, but you don't want to let Detroit score anymore. And this is a big out. You want to either strike this guy out, go after him, or try to induce him to hit into a double play.
It's time to shut the door right here. One out. fouled back, straight back. So John Henry is ahead in the count, no balls and a strike to Matt Noakes, who is hitting 327.
And with Sparky's platoon system, Noakes doesn't see a lot of left-handers.
No balls and two strikes.
So he's in an ideal situation right here.
Sparky has left him in a few times against left-handers. He has stayed with Noakes, but predominantly he faces right-handed pitching. The scoreboard has not put up either strike. There's a ball. The count now 1-2.
Well, he hung that breaking ball. BJ set up away. One thing that John Henry doesn't want to do is throw a wild pitch, a breaking ball in the dirt, but that's what you'd like to go after, make him go after, which is what he did right there. That hard breaking ball down and away, either make him strike out or beat it into the ground, see if he can, like I said before, get him to hit it into the double play. That's the situation pitch right there. The other way they can go right here, ahead in the count like this, they can go after the strikeout with a high fastball inside. Ahead in the count, you got two different ways to go. There
it is. High fastball, and Noakes goes down swinging. Strikeout number 4 for John Henry Johnson. Take another look at it. Mike, you called it perfectly.
Well, that's what you got to do. Most left-handed hitters are low ball hitters. If you want to go after them, you got to go after them up and in, and John Henry has good enough stuff to do it. They're just situation pitches. You want to get a guy to pop up or strike out. And I'm sure that's what Treb talked to him about, what you wanted to do and the pitches you wanted to do to get there.
Pitchers call that high cheese, and it worked. Sheridan squares to bunt, takes a strike. Madlock on third. He reached on an error by Jim Pachorik. Trammell on first after walking with one out here in the inning. Noakes down on strikes. Runners at the corners with two outs. And again, John Henry Johnson is ahead in the count, 0-2 to Pat Sheridan. Juan Nieves has ceased to throw pitches in the bullpen. The 0-2 pitch. 1-2.
Well, now they've got a go the rest of the way here, Jim. Good thinking baseball. They were in trouble. You're not going to let the league's leading hitter beat you. You pitch around him, walk him to get to the two left-handers. And John Henry completed one task. Let's see if he can do another.
Popped up. There may be room for Pachorik. This one is drifting foul and out of play. It hit the camera deck on the third base side. One ball and two strikes. Detroit went up 4-0 in the first. The Brewers have come back, and John Henry Johnson gets out of a jam. Runners at the corners, and he strikes out Noakes and now Sheridan. Strikeout number 5 in the inning. So through 5 complete at Tiger Stadium, it's a 4-2 ball game. Detroit leading on the Brewer Television Network. A 4-2 lead into the sixth inning. Terrell will face Cooper, Deer, and Brock as the Brewers try to scratch their way back into this one. They came up with two runs in the fifth inning, a leadoff home run by Glenn Braggs into the upper deck in right field. B.J. Surhoff reached on a bunt and later scored in the inning. It's 4-2. Cecil Cooper 0-2 tonight. He has grounded out and flied out, hitting .257. He looks at a ball from Walt Terrell. Toronto currently leads New York by a game and a half in the East. The Brewers are in third place, 5 games out. Detroit in fourth, 5.5 back. Toronto leading New York tonight, 3-0 in the third inning. When Toronto beat New York on Monday night, it was the first time since 1983 that the lead changed hands after May in the Eastern Division. Hit in the air, Lemon back quickly. He has room and makes the catch at the track. Cooper retired on another fly ball to Chet Lemon in center field. One away in the Brewers' sixth.
Poor Coop
In his last two at-bats, he's hit about 800 feet worth of out. 430 to dead center field back in the fourth, and about 380 there.
Rob Deere has struck out twice tonight. An excuse me comebacker, and Deere will be retired. So there are quickly two down here in the Brewers' sixth. Toronto is playing good baseball right now. They have been all year long. The Jays have not lost more than two straight. If you can avoid those three-game losing streaks, you're going to be in the hunt.
Be nice to be able to avoid 12-game losing streaks.
Toronto has outscored New York 20-2 so far in that three-game series. 11-0 on Monday night, 7-2 last night, and so far tonight, 3-0. Greg Brock has grounded out twice to Lou Whitaker at second base. The 0-1 pitch. It's 0-2 on the foul ball. You mentioned that Whitaker has been a mainstay at second base. He was involved in an experiment. They thought about playing him in third. Hit hard and foul down the left field line.
That was one of Sparky's experiments a couple of years back. You know, Sparky is known for the, he has that flair for the dramatic and the superlative, and the guy's name you may remember was Chris Patero, who I believe is now in the Twins organization.
Again, Brock hitting the ball very hard, but he is just not getting around quite far enough.
But in Sparky's mind at that time, this guy was the greatest thing to come along, I think, since Rogers Hornsby.
Who hasn't been? Sparky is the master of the overstatement.
And he was so good, they were going to move Whitaker to third base. Well, that didn't last too long. And I think it put a lot of pressure on the youngster, too, on Patero.
But the point I made earlier is basically Whitaker and Trammell have been mainstays. There is a base hit. Greg Brock picks up a two-out base hit to right field here in the sixth inning, so the Brewers stay alive. Hit number four in the ballgame for Milwaukee. And Glenn Braggs will step to the plate. He homered to right field in his last at bat. Braggs will remember his 100th career hit, won't he? A home run to the upper deck at Tiger Stadium. Braggs has seven home runs and 27 RBI. Four runs on six hits with an error for the Tigers. The Brewers have two runs, four base hits, and also one mistake in the field. The 1-0 pitch. Fouled into the upper deck. San Francisco 9-4, a final over Cincinnati. That game played at Riverfront this afternoon. Atlanta has beaten Los Angeles tonight 7-1 in Atlanta. San Diego and Houston are scoreless in the second. The 1-1 pitch. Two balls and a strike to Glenn Braggs.
Now, they got a reading on that earthquake. They say it was centered in Lawrenceville, Illinois.
Do we have a Richter reading on it?
Well, we missed it down here on the intercom.
2-2 the count to Braggs. The Mets beat the Cubs today 13-2. Montreal leads Pittsburgh 3-2 in the eighth. And it's St. Louis 2, Philadelphia nothing. Sixth inning in Philadelphia. Two balls, two strikes, two outs. Sixth inning at Tiger Stadium. Brock on first base, and now Braggs is hit by the pitch. And that hurt him a little bit. He took that one right in the lower part of the back.
That looked like Terrell was trying to get in on Braggs, get inside on him. You can see Noakes set up there. That ball just ran, kept running, and Braggs turned into it like it caught him in the ribs.
The second time this season that Braggs has been hit by a pitch. So Brock moves over into scoring position at second base with two outs. B.J. Surhoff reached on a bunt, a hard smash. Evans will find.
What a play.
A fine play by Darrell Evans. Touchdown Braggs on the force at second base. The Brewers come up with a hit. No runs in their half of the sixth. The Tigers coming to bat with a 4-2 lead. You're on the Brewer Television Network.
Here in the Tiger six, Nieves, who was hit on the leg his last start and is scheduled to go this weekend in New York, makes his 12th appearance of the year, and this is his first in relief.
Darrell Evans leads it off in the bottom of the sixth inning. Evans 1-for-2 tonight. An RBI single in the first inning. He drove in the fourth run in the four-run Tiger burst.
Well, if you're looking for a bit of a silver lining here tonight, I guess it could be John Henry Johnson, who had by far his best outing of the year. Well, last year, John Henry really did a nice job out of the bullpen, but he got a late start in spring training because of injuries. He's been on a disabled list this year and just hasn't been able to get on track until tonight.
The 2-1 pitch taken high for a ball, 3-1 to Evans. John Henry went five innings tonight, did not allow a run, gave up just one hit, struck out five and walked two. Three balls and two strikes now, the count full to Darrell Evans. And that couldn't have come at a better time for John Henry, because in his previous outing against New York on Friday, he lasted just two-thirds of an inning, giving up seven runs, five earned, with seven hits. Nieves walks the first batter that he faces. The third walk in the ballgame for the Tigers, and Evans is aboard here in the sixth inning for Chet Lemon, with Tom Brookins due up next. Lemon is 0-for-2, a strikeout and a fly ball, hitting 240. Hit in the air, Yount seems to have room, Deer is back, and Deer makes the play. Evans bluffs a move towards second base and returns to first. One out here in the sixth. Lemon gave that one a ride, his second fly ball out to Rob Deer in left field. And now the third baseman, Tom Brookins, steps in looking for his first base hit of the night.
Well, I think Deer called Robin off. There's Bazio up and throwing, because Evans had gone back to tag. I believe if Robin made the catch, they might have tested Robin's arm, and Evans would have tried to go to second base.
Brookins looks at a ball inside. Nieves went 3 2/3 before he was hit in the knee on Friday night against New York. And he gave up five earned runs and six hits in that span. Picked up the loss. Nieves is 4-3. Cerrone hit a home run off Juan in that ballgame.
But it was Kittle who did him in. Ron Kittle hit the line drive back off his knee.
I was in the press box, and you could hear the crack of the bat and the crack of the leg. Fortunately, there were no broken bones. A couple of inches higher, and Nieves might have had a kneecap problem. One ball and two strikes to Brookins.
Or to the side. Jim had caught him on the side, really.
Inside of the right knee.
Yep.
One out with a runner on first. A hard smash. A great play by Swain. That's one and two. The Brewers turn the double play to get out of the inning. Swain, Gantner to Brock. It's a 1-2-3-6 for the Brewers. We've completed six at Tiger Stadium. The score is 4-2 Detroit. You're on the Brewer Television Network. The Earth move a little bit in the first inning with four runs and lead the Brewers 4-2. As we move into the seventh inning, the Richter scale reading is in. The earthquake tonight, a 5, we're told. Here's Mike with the 7.
Okay, Jim, and it will be Jimmy Gantner against Terrell. Gantner has been on base twice. He singled and reached on an error charged to Whitaker back in the fifth inning. Gantner hitting at 283 with his 1-for-2 tonight. Fouls out of play. Well, Jeanette Acker of Sturtevant, Wisconsin is our contestant. In the Miller Lite TV18 rally inning contest. Two balls and one strike. She has already won a Brewer warm-up jacket. If the Brewers score here, we'll add a VIP treatment package for Jeanette and friends at County Stadium, courtesy of Miller Lite and TV18. Haven't had a winner for a while. See if we can do it tonight. Two balls and two strikes. Hit in the air, left field. Drifting back is Gibson, and there's one out. So Gantner is 1-for-3, and Dale Swaim will step to the plate. Swaim has flied to left and sacrificed. Back in the fourth inning, when the Brewers scored twice off Terrell, this one an easy play. And Swaim retired 1-3. Swaim made a good play, that double play ball to end the sixth. Ball hit hard off the bat of Brookins. And I believe Jim McKean, the umpire, might have gotten in his way. But Swaim stayed right with it, then turned the double play. Pachorik is 0-for-3. He has driven in a run, drove home a run in the fifth on a ground ball hit to Brookins with the infield playing back. Two balls and no strikes.
The attendance tonight, Mike, again, right around the average this season, 16,998 at Tiger Stadium tonight, 353 more than last night.
There's a strike. Tigers' attendance down just a bit. But they were off to a very slow start. 2-1 pitch, strike two call, fastball caught the outside corner. Two balls, two strikes to Pachorik, Detroit native. Good all-round high school athlete in this area. Paul Carey, the radio announcer for the Tigers, saying that Pachorik was an outstanding high school quarterback. Of course, he comes from the athletic family we've told you about, his brother Tom, at Texas. Had a couple of other brothers who played minor league baseball, and one other who actually played with Houston. Appeared in one game, went 3-for-3, and that was it in his career, wasn't that, Jim?
I believe so. Pachorik graduated from the University of Michigan in Ann Arbor. Played football, baseball, all Big Ten, three times, and a two-time All-American.
There's ball four. The second walk
issued by Terrell, and Robin Yount comes to the plate looking for his first base hit in this series. 0 for 2 tonight and 0 for 6 in the series. He has walked once tonight.
Pachorek, Mike, a three-sport all-stater in Michigan, football, basketball, and baseball.
There's a strike call. Fouled out of play, and Terrell ahead of Yount. No balls and two strikes. Eric King, hard throwing right-hander, loosening up in the Tiger bullpen. No balls, two strikes, two outs. Brewers trailing 4-2 in the top of the seventh. Pitches high with a breaking ball. One ball and two strikes. Low ball two. Count even at 2-2. Willie Hernandez, the left-hander, has joined Eric King. Line drive, base hit for Robin. Pachorek will hold at second base as Lemon over quickly and gets the ball back into the infield. So Robin has his first base hit in the series, and the Brewers have runners at first and second with two outs. Fastball about middle of the plate, belt high, and Lemon really came on quickly to get that ball as Pachorek put on the brakes. Fifth base hit off Terrell. And Cooper also looking for his first base hit in this series. He had a 10-game hitting streak snapped last night when he took an 0 for 4. He's hit the ball well tonight, but nothing to show for it. Fouled out of play. After grounding back to the pitcher in the first inning, Cooper set Chet Lemon all the way to the warning track in straightaway center field about 430 feet away in the fourth, and then to the gap in left center field in the sixth.
He's hitting the ball hard. How about a pull down the right field line? Cooper, one of 21 hitters to knock a ball out of this stadium. Be a good time right here, wouldn't it?
Hit deep to right field. Jimmy called it. It's gone, a home run. And the Brewers lead 5-4. Home run number 5 for Cooper. RBIs number 23, 24, and 25. And congratulations to Janet Acker of Sturtevant, Wisconsin. Cecil Cooper's home run will win her a warm-up jacket and a VIP treatment package for Janet and three of her friends. And here's another look.
An inside fastball. Well, he didn't knock it out of the ballpark, but he did put it out of the playing field, into the runway in the upper deck. A three-run shot for Cooper.
Line to left field by Deer. But foul. Nice call. So Janet Acker. Janet or Jeanette. J-E-A-N-E-T-T of Sturtevant.
I must have had a feeling. Cecil 0 for 3 in the ball game. 0 for 4 last night, he was due. Sometimes you just get the feeling that a guy is going to rip one. And he nailed that pitch.
Well, the importance of that long man, huh? John Henry Johnson came in, shut him down, and allowed the ball club to get back into the ball game. Now let's see if they can hang on. Danny Plesac has gotten up in the Brewer bullpen. Deer hits it high in the air to left field. Gibson going back and makes the catch at the fence. So the Brewers retired here in the seventh, but they come back with three runs on two base hits. The home run by Cooper puts the Brewers ahead 5-4 as we go to the bottom of the seventh on the Brewer Television Network.
Milestone homers. We mentioned that Braggs hit a home run for his 100th career hit. The home run by Cooper is home run number 200.
0-2 pitch. Just misses off the outside corner. One ball and two strikes. Here they come. 1-2. Tapped back to the mound. Nieves will throw him out. And Whitaker retired for out number one. Well, I think that was a home run that Coop really earned. Go back, we talked about 800 feet of outs. He's hit the ball about 1,200 feet tonight on three different occasions, so he deserved that one, didn't he?
And if you throw in Rob Deere's long fly ball out, between the two, you have about 1,600 feet of fly ball.
1,600 feet of one for four.
Yeah, but three runs.
Okay. Here's Madlock, who's been on base twice, and taps this one right at third. A bad hop, and Pachorek will not have a play. Ball came up on Pachorek. He has had his problems in the field tonight, and he will be charged with his second error.
Both times on balls hit by Madlock. Playable ball, Mike.
Well, that last hop came up. You can see Pachorek has the glove down. The ball comes up. It bounces away from him, so he's unable to make the play. The second error charged to the Brewers and to Pachorek, and Gibson looks at a strike. Madlock now on base for the third time tonight. He's reached twice by error. Singled and scored in the first. Gibson, 1-for-3.
You have to feel for Pachorek. As he told you before the game, he has a lot of friends and family here, being from the Detroit area. He played third base very well in spring training. That was the position that Tom Treblehorn put him at when he said, all right, show us what else you can do, and he made the ball flip.
Fouled straight back.
Where did that go?
Just above us.
All I did was see the seed and hit the deck.
So Nieves had a ball and two strikes with one out.
That had a sinker rotation on it.
1-2 pitch. Just missed. Well, I think that Pachorek is in the lineup tonight for his bat. Juan Castillo struggling a bit. Molitor not able to play. And we may see a defensive replacement in the eighth. Again, fouled back. In fact, I was a bit surprised not to see one of them in there this particular inning, because Pachorek led off the seventh. The Brewers went ahead, and ordinarily that defensive man would go in there. Two balls, two strikes with Madlock at first. Again, fouled back. And Jim Paschke has just left the booth. Plesac, the left-hander, Bazio, the right-hander. Well, we comment about it every time we come in here. Very precarious situation here in this booth. And Gibson is one of the guys who fouls it back this way most often. You really have to be on your toes. There's Trepp. Paul Molitor standing with him. And Tony Migliaccio, the clubhouse, the equipment manager, also there. 3-2 pitch. Got him. And Gibson slams the bat in disgust. He did it again. Once wasn't enough for Gibson. He pounded it at home plate. And then did it again. The express right down the middle. First strikeout for Nieves. Trammell coming up, and we're going to have a pitching change. I believe Bazio coming in, and we'll pause for these messages on the Brewer Television Network.
Against New York, he went 2 2/3, gave up a hit, no runs, and struck out 5. So Bazio comes on, the fourth Brewer pitcher tonight, and Juan Nieves did a pretty fair job through 2 innings. He did not allow a run or a hit, walked 1 and struck out 1.
So Bazio will face a tough out here. Alan Trammell, the American League's leading hitter. Trammell is 1 for 2 tonight. He has driven home a run with a base hit. Hits in the air left field. Deer is there. And the inning is over. So Bazio comes on to retire Trammell for the Tigers here in the 7th. No runs, no hits. There was 1 Brewer error. And 1 man left. After 7, the Brewers 5. Detroit 4 on the Brewer Television Network. Go to the 8th. It will be left-hander Willie Hernandez making his 24th appearance. Hernandez, take that back. Hernandez making his 9th appearance. He's 0-1 with a 7.45 earned run average. And no saves. And that's not the kind of line that you expect to see from Willie Hernandez.
Greg Brock hits the first pitch. It is foul down the left field line.
And the reception that he received was not the kind that you would expect. Hernandez roundly booed here at Tiger Stadium. Remember, a few years back, they were on their feet when he came in.
1984, when he came over and brought a screwball along with him, a very effective screwball that American League hitters were not accustomed to seeing, and that screwball helped Willie Hernandez earn the MVP and the Cy Young Award, not to mention a world championship here in Detroit. 0-1 to Brock. There's a strike. 0-2 to count. In 84, Hernandez had 32 saves, 31 in 85, and 24 saves in 86. Let's pause 5 seconds for station identification. You're on the Brewer Television Network.
You're watching the Brewers tackle the Tigers on Super 18 WVTV Milwaukee.
And the Brewers have come back to take a 5-4 lead over the Tigers. Detroit scored 4 times in the first. The Brewers 2 in the 5th and 3 in the 7th. Colders will win one for the kids and Children's Hospital during Super 18 Brewer telecast this year. Each time the Brewers win a TV game, Colders will donate $100 to Children's Hospital of Wisconsin. A shutout will bring a $300 donation from Colders, and a no-hitter, $500 to Two Children's Hospital.
Hernandez off to a slow start this year, Jim. He has been on the disabled list. Of course, you know, Sparky Anderson.
There's a base hit for Brock, his second hit in the ball game. A single to center field, and the Brewers have the leadoff man aboard here in the eighth.
When Hernandez started to have his problems last year, Sparky began to use that bullpen by committee, if you will, that a lot of clubs are using. Fastball, middle of the plate. Good swing by Brock. He's 2-for-4. But Thurmond and King out of the bullpen, so Hernandez not getting the consistent kind of work that he was used to. He's not as sharp. He's just coming in now to face left-handers.
Len Braggs has homered tonight. And he was hit by a pitch in his last at bat in the sixth.
And he doesn't ordinarily throw that screwball to left-handers, so his most effective pitch really has been taken away from him.
Hernandez has been working on a cut fastball. He'll slip that one in there once in a while. Particularly effective to a right-handed hitter like Braggs from the left-handed pitcher.
Well, a guy who doesn't throw real hard and throws that screwball, what happened is that, there's Danny Plesac still throwing, is that the guys are going to make him bring the screwball up in the strike zone, lay off of it. And when he gets behind in the count, he doesn't have anything to put the right-hander away. They're leaning out over the plate, so he's got to have something to back that right-hander off the plate to make the screwball more effective.
Well, he was behind in the count to Braggs, and excuse me, ground ball. Evans with the putout, and Brock moves over to second base. A runner in scoring position now with one out in the Brewer eighth inning. Plesac had been up and throwing in the bullpen, and then he put the jacket back on, took a seat, and now he's back up and throwing again.
Well, when you look at the Tiger lineup and what they've got coming up in the eighth, with Noakes, Sheridan, and Evans, three lefties, I believe Trev's going to force Sparky to either go with the lefties or make his moves.
Those left-handers will see some heat if Plesac comes into the game. The 1-0 pitch, the runner going. Noakes throws down, and Brock is in at third.
Boy, I'll tell you, they never even gave him a look. Brookins, not for one instant, was anticipating the steal by Brock. There you see it right there. You don't see Brock in that picture. But Brookins had to come from way in the hole at third base. And Hernandez never even looked at Brock.
That was a good pitch for Noakes to handle. And Brookins, had he been able to get over to third base more quickly, may have been able to handle what was a pretty good throw from Noakes.
Well, you're absolutely right, but it was the element of surprise more than anything else. It's like the delayed steal. Certainly, if everything was right, Brock would have been out, but they just caught a couple of people napping is what happened. Hernandez for one and Brookins for another.
You can't take anything away from Brock. Heady base running. Stolen base number 3 for Brock. A 2-1 pitch coming up to B.J. Surhoff. Two balls and two strikes. B.J. 1-for-3 tonight, a bunt single in the fifth. A deep fly ball with one out. Good score, Brock from third base. An insurance run, pitch away. Handled nicely by Noakes. The count is full now, 3 balls and 2 strikes.
Good play here by Noakes on that big sweeping curveball from Hernandez.
The payoff pitch hit on the ground. Whitaker at second, the runner. Brock will hold at third, and there are two down. Two away in the Brewer eight for Jim Gantner with Brock on third base. Toronto leads New York now 3-1 in the seventh inning. Boston 11-3 over Baltimore in the seventh. Cleveland and California just underway. Oakland has beaten Chicago 5-2, and Kansas City leads Minnesota 3-0 in the seventh. Texas has a late start out in Seattle. Jim Gantner singled in his first at bat back in the third, reached on an error in the fifth, and flied out in the seventh. Popped up, Brookins. The Tigers are out of the eighth inning. The Brewers come up with a hit. They strand him. Black on third. After 7.5, Milwaukee leads Detroit 5-4 on the Brewer Television Network. Fouling back the first pitch from Danny Plesac. Plesac, as Mike told you, with 13 saves. And I believe last year, I want to check before I say this, but I believe last year he had 14. Plesac had 14 saves in 86, so he can perhaps match that total. There's Mike Heath.
Well, that's what that slider will do to you, that good, hard slider inside. And Heath just hit it right straight down, looked like on the foot or the instep. Hard slider breaking down, and that got Heath on the left foot.
Mike Heath, always very animated. We saw it behind the plate last night. I think you may have used the term flaky.
Yeah. Same meaning.
You bet. The 0-2 pitch, swing and a miss, strike three. Heath is retired on strikes. Number one for Plesac, and that is the seventh strikeout tonight.
Set up outside, and the slider is inside, but in a good spot down.
Larry Herndon will bat for Pat Sheridan as the managers manage. A lot of changes here. Oh, right back up the middle. Base hit, Herndon. A screamer past Plesac.
Jumps on the first pitch, low fastball. Herndon homered last night.
Darrell Evans is 1-4-2 with a walk tonight. One out in the eighth inning. The Brewers lead by a run, 5-4. Herndon is on first base. Plesac works Evans away for a ball. One ball and no strikes.
Herndon's done a good job pinch hitting, Jim. That's his fourth pinch hit of the year. He's 4-for-10.
Up high, 2-0 to count. Chet Lemon is in the on-deck circle. Two balls and one strike. Danny Plesac has either a save or a decision in five of his last six appearances. He picked up a win Saturday night when he went head-to-head with Dave Righetti. Fouled back, 2-2. The two best stoppers in the American League. Arguably the two best in baseball. Both were tagged for two runs, and Plesac benefited from that two-out, bases-loaded bunt single by Surhoff and picked up his first win of the season. The two runs given up by Danny in the game, a two-run home run by Dave Winfield. 2-2 with one out. Evans holds up. Three balls and two strikes. In his three appearances prior to the victory, Plesac picked up saves, 11, 12, and 13. Going for number 14 tonight to equal last year's save total. Payoff pitch is wide. Runners at first and second with one out. The fourth walk by Brewer pitching tonight. Herndon moves over to second. Evans is on first. Chet Lemon is 0-for-3, a strikeout, and two fly balls to Rob Deeren left. Look for fastballs in to Lemon. He goes inside out. If it's fair, it's trouble. It's fair. Here comes Herndon. That ties the score. Evans will be held, and now situation. Lemon is tagged out by Dale Swain. Two outs in the inning, but the game is tied. Lemon with an RBI single.
Well, that ball jammed him. Little looping fly ball. Good hustle here by Manning. Herndon will score, and Lemon kind of running with his head down because Grammas had held up the runner at third base. Now they've got Lemon in the rundown. The tag applied by Dale Swain. It'll go 9-4-6, but we are tied.
It has been scored as a two-base hit for Lemon, retired by Swain. Here's the 0-1 pitch to Tom Brookins. Popped up. Swain is back. The outfielders have to come on a long way. Swain makes the play. And that's the end of the Tiger eighth inning. A couple of hits. One run is in. The game is even. 5-5 after eight on the Brewer Television Network.
Join the Duke clan, Bo, Luke, Daisy, and Uncle Jesse as they match wits with Boss Hogg and Sheriff Roscoe P. Coltrane on the Dukes of Hazzard every Sunday morning at 10, right here on Super 18.
We move into the ninth inning at Tiger Stadium. The Brewers and Detroit are tied at 5-5. We have a couple of defensive changes. Larry Herndon will stay on in right field after hitting for Sheridan, and Mike Heath will be behind the plate replacing Matt Noakes. Willie Hernandez on the mound. He came on in relief of Walt Terrell facing Dale Swain to lead off the ninth inning. Hernandez came on in the eighth inning. Terrell went seven, gave up five runs, four of them earned. Hernandez faced four batters in the eighth, giving up one hit. One ball and one strike to Dale Swain. As it stands at the moment, Hernandez and Plesac will be the pitchers of record. Two balls and a strike to Swain. Dale has flied out, grounded out, and he had a sacrifice. In the air, right field, Herndon makes the play. One away in the Brewer ninth.
Now, Mike Felder will come to the plate, so he's going to hit in Pachurik's spot. Manning out on deck will hit in Yount's spot, and Castillo, who also came into the ballgame, will hit down in Bragg's position.
Yeah. Felder hits the first pitch, and he sends Herndon back to the track in right. And Herndon has retired the first two batters here in the Brewer ninth inning. A report on Robin Yount. We were surprised that he was removed from the game.
A slight strain in the right shoulder, not believed to be serious.
Two down here in the ninth for Rick Manning. On the outside corner for a strike. Rick is hitting 276. No home runs. He has driven in two runs. And that is an out. Not quite enough. Trammell back for the fly ball out. Three up, three down in the Brewer ninth. Tied at five on the Brewer Television Network. Number three hitter, Kirk Gibson. A two-run triple in the first inning. After that, a couple of strikeouts and a ground out to the shortstop. The Brewers have five runs on seven hits with two errors. The Tigers, five runs, nine hits, and one error. Danny Plesac, the fifth Brewer pitcher tonight. A strike on the inside corner to Gibson. Len Barker pitched to five batters in the first inning and gave up four runs on six hits. John Henry Johnson came on and worked five innings of scoreless baseball, an outstanding middle relief appearance for John Henry tonight. Juan Nieves, two hitless innings. Bazio came on and retired the third out in the seventh. Plesac has worked the eighth and now the ninth. One ball and one strike.
Jim, we got another word that Braggs left the ball game with a slight bruise on the left hip.
Hit by the pitch. One ball and two strikes to Gibson.
So a couple of little nagging injuries to Robin and to Braggs.
The Tigers with four in the first and then one in the eighth to tie it. The Brewers, two in the fifth, three in the seventh on a home run, a three-run shot by Cooper into the upper deck in right field. Braggs homered in the game, a solo shot to lead off the fifth inning for Milwaukee. The 1-2 pitch. Gibson has gone on strikes for the third time tonight. All three swinging. Strikeout number eight for Brewer pitching. The second for Plesac.
Well, he just challenged him right there with a fastball, low and away, knees on the outside corner. Gibson's had a tough night after the first inning.
And now the number one hitter in the American League, Alan Trammell, 358.
Well, as you were talking, Jim, about the fine relief effort here tonight, after that first inning, the Tigers were shut down until the eighth, were held hitless. Good job by John Henry, by Nieves, Bazio.
There's a strike. 0-1 to Alan Trammell. Danny Plesac. He didn't even pitch until he was a senior in high school. And now he is one of the premier relievers in baseball. Trying to take the Brewers into the 10th inning. This should do it. A ground ball, a little lollipop throw, but Castillo makes the put out, and the game is going into the 10th. Tied at five on the Brewer Television Network.
one of the reasons they call him Sweet Lou. He is smooth around second base. Nice play here as we take another look.
The Brewers are 3-1 in extra inning games, and they have not lost an extra inning ball game on the road. 3-0. Detroit 3-3 when they have to work overtime.
So Coop is 1-for-5, but the big one, a three-run homer in the seventh at the time, gave the Brewers a 5-4 lead. Rob Deere 0-for-4 tonight. He has struck out twice. King is just 22 years old, 6'2", 180 pounds, out of Oxford, California.
He's really turning into a steal, Mike. He was involved in that Dave LaPointe trade to San Francisco in 85, and this guy has come on very strong.
Outside. Two balls and two strikes. Last year with the Tigers, he was 11-4 with three saves. Started 16 ball games. That ball took the glove right off of Mike Keith. Tell you, he is something back there, isn't he, Heath? I think he might be a couple of cards short of a full deck. High ball four. And that is not meant in a derogatory way. We talked about him being flaky last night. He's flaky tonight, too.
Some things never change.
So the go-ahead run aboard here for the Brewers with one out in the 10th. And Greg Brock, who has singled his last two times up. Brock 2-for-4. And King misses with the breaking ball. The Tigers took a 4-0 lead in the first inning off Len Barker. Barker failed to get anybody out. But John Henry Johnson came on in relief and pitched 5 scoreless innings. 2 balls and no strikes. That allowed the Brewers to come back, scoring twice in the 5th and 3 in the 7th to take a 5-4 lead before the Tigers tied it up in the 8th on a Chet Lemon double.
I mentioned that King was a steal in that trade. Matt Noakes came over in that trade as well. Dave LaPointe, I believe Juan Berenguer was involved in that deal, but I think Detroit came out of that one pretty well with Eric King and Matt Noakes. Noakes hitting over 300 and Eric King, a power relief pitcher.
Back through the middle, base hit. Deere will try to go for third, and he will make it as that ball dies in the outfield. And Brock has 3 hits in his last 3 times at bat. Boy, he hit a bullet right back through the middle.
A big hit, a fastball away, right back through the box at the ankles of Eric King. Now that ball just dies. Look at it stop out there. And here's Deere.
Boy, he got his
he got tangled up.
Yep.
Tony Muser was signaling stay up to Rob Deere, and he might have had slide on his mind, but he got the spikes tangled.
He got caught in between, and a lot of times that's how guys got hurt. You remember Pedro Guerrero. Well, we'll have a pinch hitter. Paul Molitor is out on deck. He will pinch hit for Castillo. Mark Thurman, the left-hander up in the Tiger bullpen, as Sirhoff will follow. So Pauly making his first appearance since Saturday night. And now the wheels start to turn on both sides as
Sparky Anderson makes his way to the mound. They will, of course, talk about Molitor. How they're going to pitch him, how they're going to defend him.
Paul hitting 339. This is his first pinch hit appearance of the season. Four home runs, 22 runs batted in, and of course, he leads the club with 11 doubles.
Cooper led off the inning with a ground out, a nice play by Whitaker at second base. Deer walked, and Brock singled him to third. Molitor fouls it back. A slider fouled out of play. So King ahead of Molitor, no balls and one strike. Pitch out, and that ball almost got away from Heath.
He might have gotten away from the ball. Mike Heath continues to amaze. Oh, you've got to like guys like that, don't you?
Well, they keep the game interesting. It's not boring, that's for sure. Strike inside. Paulie couldn't pull the trigger on an inside breaking ball in the count. One ball and two strikes.
I wonder if Heath talks like he moves. It would be tough to keep your concentration at the plate, wouldn't it?
Deer at third and Brock at first. Heath set up outside and Molitor fouls it back. The count remains one ball and two strikes. Five-five in the top of the 10th. The Brewers with 8 hits and 2 errors. The Tigers, 9 hits. And they have committed 1 error. Swing and a miss. He struck him out. It looked like Paulie chased a bad pitch. Down and away. A slider that broke out of the strike zone. And he had Molly out in front. So the second trip by Sparky will have a pitching change with a score tied 5-5 in the 10th. A lefty coming on. We'll be back after these messages on the Brewer Television Network.
For the Tigers, Eric King went two-thirds of an inning. Thurman making his 23rd appearance. He is 0-1 with 4 saves and a 2.91 earned run average in 21 and two-thirds innings. 7 strikeouts and 8 walks for Mark Thurman. We saw him last night.
Pitched two-thirds of an inning last night. Gave up a base hit, but that was it in Morris's victory. So runners at first and third with 2 out. And B.J. Surhoff up there looks at a strike. Surhoff is 1-for-4. He singled back in the 5th. Hit in the air, deep to right center field. And this ball is gone. A home run for BJ. His 3rd home run of the year, and the Brewers take an 8-5 lead. Oh, B.J. Surhoff continues his clutch hitting. And the Brewers lead 8-5.
The rookie has a flair for the dramatic, doesn't he? The second three-run homer of the game. Cooper hit one, and Surhoff greets Mark Thurmond with this shot to right center field. Oh, my, it's 8-5. That is fun to watch when a kid can come on and win ball games as he did Saturday night, and now he has put the Brewers in position for the win.
Tap back up the middle. The throw by Whitaker will end it here in the 10th, but the Brewers come up with three big runs on B.J. Surhoff's third home run of the year. They do it on two base hits. Nobody left, and we go to the bottom of the 10th. The score, Milwaukee 8, Detroit 5 on the Brewer Television Network. In the 10th for the Tigers, Heath, Herndon, and Evans. Heath came on to pinch hit for Matt Noakes in the 8th and struck out against Plesac. The Brewers have battled back here tonight, trying to snap a two-game losing streak. A strike to Heath.
Danny Plesac in position for the win, and this is his longest relief appearance of the year. He has gone two innings twice before, and he is working into his third inning here tonight.
Two balls and one strike on the Tiger catcher with Larry Herndon on deck. Tapped wide at third base. Swaim, long throw, got him. Heath retired 6-3 for out number one. You know, Jim, there have been other rookies this year who have probably made bigger splashes than B.J. Surhoff. But day in and day out and down the road, this guy has got a chance to be as good or better than any of them. He is just so tough. He is a clutch player. There's a strike. And you know, he's learning a tough position to catch at the big league level.
Well, he's tough on himself, too. He pushes himself every day.
Little looping fly ball. Swaim can't get it. So Herndon is 2-for-2. Came on in the 8th with a pinch hit single. Batting for Sheridan. And just looped this one out of the reach of Swaim.
Very close.
But we're talking about guys like McGuire. Noakes has had a good start here. Some other people who have maybe put bigger numbers on the board, but you watch B.J. day in and day out. There's a strike to Evans. He walked facing Plesac back in the 8th inning. He's 1-for-2 tonight. Plesac looking for his second victory of the year, playing behind Herndon at first base is Brock. The Brewers scored twice in the 5th, 3 in the 7th, and 3 in the 10th. The Tigers took the lead in the first inning, scoring 4 times off Len Barker, who failed to get anybody out. But good relief pitching has kept the Brewers in this ball game. One ball and two strikes. Strike 3. The third for Plesac. And there are now 2 out.
Strikeout number 9 for the Brewer pitching staff tonight. And that's just a good, hard fastball.
Chet Lemon is one for four. So the Brewers one out away here from a comeback victory. And Lemon looks at a ball down low and inside. One oh pitch, high ball two. Plesac, the fifth Brewer pitcher. Sparky Anderson has used four, so nine pitchers in this game tonight. 2-0 pitch, ball three. There's a strike. 3-1 to Lemon. He didn't think so, and lets John Schulock know it. Coming back 3-1, strike two called. So Plesac, who had fallen behind 3-0, is now back to 3-2. Herndon will go on the pitch. Three balls, two strikes, two outs. Fouled it back. Tom Brookins would be next if Lemon can get aboard. Side, ball four. Lemon walks. Herndon to second. And the tying run comes to the plate. There you see Tom Treblehorn. And Sparky Anderson, his counterpart. And they just don't come easy, do they?
Not at all. Brookins is 0 for 4 tonight.
This could do it. Swain to Gantner retires the side, and the Brewers win it here in 10. The final score, Milwaukee 8, Detroit 5. And we will be back with more after these messages on the Brewer Television Network.
Made in America since 1905. We have elected B.J. Surhoff as the player of the game, and $100 will be donated to the Mac Fund in his name, courtesy of Miller Lite and Super 18. B.J. Surhoff with a three-run homer in the 10th, his fifth game-winning RBI, and the Brewers win it tonight by the score of 8-5. And Mike, they are 4-1 in extra-inning ball games, 4-0 on the road. And with tonight's victory, Colder's is donating $100 to the Children's Hospital of Wisconsin. We salute the Brewers and Colder's for winning one for the kid.
Well, it was B.J. Surhoff's home run that did it in the 10th, Jim, but really it was the relief pitching after Lenny Barker that held the Brewers in the ballgame. A good job by John Henry Johnson, who came on and pitched five innings of shutout ball, then Juan Nieves. Bazio and Danny Plesac gave up the tying run, but again hung in there, and the Brewers win it in 10 innings on that big home run by B.J. Surhoff off a left-handed pitcher. B.J. has really done a good job in the clutch this year.
All right. Braggs, Cooper, and Surhoff with home runs tonight. Jim Paschke for Mike Hegan saying so long from Tiger Stadium in Detroit. The Brewers and the Tigers will play a day game tomorrow, and then it's on to New York, where the Brewers and the Yankees open up a three-game series at Yankee Stadium. Our next telecast will be Friday night from New York. We will be televising all three games from Yankee Stadium. Airtime Friday, 6:30 Central. Once again, tonight's final score, Milwaukee 8, Detroit 5 in 10 innings. Until Friday night, so long. This has been the Milwaukee Brewers Television Network.